Hey everyone, Brian Zane here with another classic pay-per-view review as nominated on by my Patreon backers. This week I'm going down to Las Vegas, Nevada, April 4th, 1993. Caesar's Palace hosts WrestleMania 9. This was nominated to me by Tim Russell and Mitchell Janda. This is my most requested WrestleMania I have on my database of suggestions from my backers. This show is widely regarded as one of the worst WrestleManias of all time for plenty of justifiable reasons. I've said as much on this show as well, but there's also a couple of hidden gems that are worth looking at and praising, in my opinion. First, let's take a look at the setting here. It's, you know, the first outdoor WrestleMania. It's in the sunny desert of Las Vegas, Nevada. They got the whole Roman theme going on, being at Caesar's Palace. Even the crew members, the cameramen, are dressed up in togas. The world's largest toga party is how they hailed it. People think this is kind of cheesy, but I actually think this is kind of one of the few redeeming qualities of Mania 9, is just they go all out with this Roman setting here, and everyone's in the outfits, and they got the columns, and everything looks nice. They have the animals showing up, the whole menagerie. You got Julius Caesar and Cleopatra coming out on an elephant. Bobby Heenan coming out on a camel, which is a hilarious moment. It's just, I think just the fact they went all in on this setting, to me, I think it's just that it's to be commended for that. And I think, I actually like this. I like the look of it. It's something that I enjoyed about it. Yeah, Jim Ross, Randy Savage, and the aforementioned Bobby Heenan on commentary. This is Jim Ross's first WrestleMania, and as he says on the commentary, it's his first time wearing a toga. And I love the way Jim Ross calls stuff in this show particularly. You know, if you haven't heard Jim Ross call the Vestal Virgins with the same enthusiasm and vigor as Ron Simmons winning the world title, you truly haven't lived.
Pure a body and pure a thought are those Vestal Virgins, we are informed.
The first match of WrestleMania 9 is for the Intercontinental Championship as the Heartbreak Kid Shawn Michaels defends against Tatanka Buffalo. Tatanka is undefeated at this point in the WWF. He actually has two pinfall victories over Shawn Michaels at this point. Shawn won the IC title back in October of the previous year. This is his first of three Intercontinental Championship reigns. Interesting thing with the valets here, because Shawn is coming out with Luna Vachon and Tatanka's coming out with Sherry Martel, who was previously Shawn's valet. However, they split up early in this year when Shawn Michaels basically threw Sherry in his way to take a mirror shot for him. That was kind of where they broke off, and so now you've got Luna for protection for Shawn, and Sherry wants to get revenge here. One thing watching this match really helped remind me is the fact that Shawn Michaels, you know, for all the switches from face to heel that he made in his career, he rarely changed his style up. He was always kind of a high-flying, risk-taking individual. I've always kind of thought if you're a heel, you shouldn't do big, surprising, death-defying, fan-popping moves, because it's kind of going against the nature of what you're trying to do, what your job is as a wrestler. But I think Shawn Michaels is one of those people who can do the high-flying stuff and, you know, get a little bit of that reaction, but at the same time, people hate him so much because he's such a smug prick when he was a heel. So I think it really works for him. He's one of those few people who could really make it work. Really great match by these two guys. Really solid way to open the show, and really gives fans a false sense of security going into what's going to happen down the line. Shawn eats the apron on the outside. Then as he's getting counted out, he grabs the referee Joey Morella by the ankle, yanks him out of the ring. Shawn gets back inside, eats a slam from Tatanka. And so the referee gets back in the ring and he reacts to the slam. Then all of a sudden, as Tatanka goes to pin Shawn, he goes, ah, nope, sorry, actually I'm going to DQ the Shawn and the match is over. Hell of a dick move by the referee. Very late reaction to getting pulled out and physically manhandled by Shawn Michaels here. So it's just kind of like, yeah, oh, actually, sorry, I gotta stop the match. After the match, Luna Vachon beats the hell out of Sherry Martel and just runs off after Shawn celebrates the fact that he's got to hold on to the Intercontinental Championship. So Tatanka wins by disqualification. His undefeated streak remains intact, but he is without the belt. I give this match 2.5 stars. Great way to open the show. A really solid match. I would have given it a 3-star rating, maybe a little more, but the finish, the DQ finish, did kind of sour it for me. Up next, the Steiner brothers, Rick and Scott, take on the Head Shrinkers, Samu and Fatu, the future Rikishi, and they're managed by Wild Samoan Afa. You know, they say all men are created equal, but you look at the Steiners, you look at the Head Shrinkers, you realize the Head Shrinkers have invincible heads. That was the whole story going in this match, is the Samoans just have these giant heads that cannot be damaged. At one point, the Head Shrinkers powder out of the ring after a double top rope Steiner line, and Afa snaps them out of it and gets them psyched up by giving them, his own guys, a noggin knocker, and they no-sell it, and they're like, yeah, that psychs them back up to get in the match. I love that spot. There's a continuing thread throughout this whole show where they do a lot of callbacks on commentary to the beatdown that Sherry got from Luna at the end of the last match, and even spills into the backstage area. There's this report from JR, apparently, oh, Sherry was beat up some more by Luna backstage, and Bobby Heenan, I love his reaction.
And the details are sketchy. Just
by Luna?
Luna attacked Sensational Sherry at the first aid station.
Super!
The heels get their cut off when Scott eats shit on the outside. Like, he's going outside the ring to begin with, then one of the head shrinkers pulls the top rope down and he just, like, slides on through. Like, he misses the rope and he just totally face plants on the outside. It looks really scary. Scott takes all the heat in this match. He does avoid a Samu diving headbutt, hot tag to Rick. I love this spot here in the comeback where Rick is on Fatu's shoulders and Samu goes for a top rope move on Rick, but Rick catches him in midair and power slams him off of Fatu's shoulders. I've never seen that done before. That was an awesome spot. Scott hits Samu with the Frankensteiner with a bit of a weird looking connection there. Like, Samu flips independently of Scott doing the Frankensteiner. The Steiners win the match. Awesome tag team match. One of my favorite matches of the whole night. I give it 3 stars out of 4. In our next matchup, Crush and his sweet-ass mullet take on Doink the Clown. This is back when Doink was an evil, psychotic heel clown. Not like the baby face that everyone kind of groans about when they think about Doink the Clown. This is like Doink at his peak here. Maniac Matt Bourne doing this role here. I think he does it to perfection. I love like the smiling to frowning and back. It's just great stuff here. It's about as close as you're ever going to get to like a Joker character around this time. Just the way he acted. If you look past the silliness of the wig and the face paint, it's a really, really awesome character. In this match, Crush is fighting for the honor of all the kids out there who've been victimized by Doink's evil pranks. So that leads to this grudge match here at WrestleMania. A couple of times, Crush goes for the vice grip on Doink's head. Doink, as he's trying to fight out, decks the referee. The ref takes a bump. Crush goes for a second vice grip, and a second Doink the Clown appears. It's actually Steve Kerr. And the second Doink pulls out another prosthetic arm and just womps the shit out of Crush with it, just decks him and like almost breaks the arm in half by doing so. Then the two Doinks do this hilarious mirror spot where they're standing there and they do the movements identically to each other. Original Doink wins the match here. I give it 1.5 stars. As far as like, you know, technical prowess, it wasn't that anything we write home about. I think, again, Matt Bourne was amazing in the ring, and this character, I think the way he did it was really good, in my opinion. I think he really captured, like, he was the only guy who could really play Doink and do it well, in my opinion. Both men in our next matchup are making their WrestleMania debuts on this day. You have Razor Ramon, who debuted for the company in June of the previous year, taking on Bob Backlund, who, of course, is a former world champion. He held the belt cumulatively for over 1,000 days. He's one of the top babyfaces in the company's history after Bruno Sammartino and before Hulk Hogan. So yeah, Bob Backlund is a big deal. He took several years off of wrestling, or at least wrestling for the WWF, and now he's back here. This little comeback tour. Not much to say about this match. Don't know why it had to happen, because it's literally less than 4 minutes, the shortest match on the card. Bob Backlund hits some hip tosses. That's pretty much the best offense he'll get against Scott Hall. Scott doesn't even hit the razor's edge on this match. He beats Bob Backlund with a small package to win the match. Not much to say about it. Kind of bland. I'm going to give this 1.5 star. The tag team championships are on the line next as Money Inc. Ted DiBiase and the father of Bo Dallas and Bray Wyatt, IRS, taking on the Mega Maniacs, Hulk Hogan and Brutus Beefcake. The buildup and the circumstances leading to this match are actually kind of fascinating, because Brutus Beefcake took like 3 years or so off of wrestling because he had this horrible facial injury and a parasailing accident, had to get reconstructive surgery for his face. So he was not wrestling for a long time. He was still kind of semi-active in the WWF around this time, but just not wrestling. So his first match back from 1990 comes in 1993. He's wrestling Ted DiBiase, but IRS runs in and beats him up with a briefcase. And Hulk Hogan, who by this point had taken a very long leave of absence from the company after the accusations of steroid use started percolating, the whole Dr. Zahorian thing. This is before the steroid trial began, but it's when the accusations really started coming to light. So Hogan was off TV for a long time at this point. He comes back to save Beefcake after Jimmy Hart, who then was managing Money Inc., has a change of heart, and he wants to align himself with Beefcake and Hogan. So Hogan comes back. They're challenged for the tag team titles. Like I said, it's one of the more interesting storylines in this show, if only because of just how crazy everything is leading up to this point, with Hogan being gone and Beefcake being gone for very different reasons. One of the big stories in this whole show is how Hogan is sporting this massive black eye from something he suffered the night before. They try to cover it up in the storyline by saying that the Money Inc. hired somebody to jump Hogan at the gym the night before, but there's actually two different theories as to what really happened with Hogan's eye. The legend has it that, you know, Macho Man punched Hogan out the night before over this alleged affair that Hogan had with Miss Elizabeth. The official story that Hogan says and other officials have said over the years is that basically a rogue unmanned jet ski hit Hogan in the face the night before, and that's why he got the black eye. So, you know, you draw your own conclusions. Brother Brutai is wearing a very silly looking face mask to cover up his surgically repaired face. It bestows upon him the power of the head shrinkers, apparently, and the fact that he is impressed impervious to pain in the head and face area, and he can also deal out a lot of extra damage with it as well, so it's kind of a weapon. When Ted DiBiase rips the mask off later in the match, it's like Samson getting his hair cut. He is without his powers. He's just a crumpled heap. Every time they lightly graze his face, he just like starts selling like crazy, like death. The match ends when Brutus puts a sleeper hold on IRS. DiBiase hits Brutus from behind, so you got Brutus and IRS both falling on top of the referee, knocking him out. Hogan and Beefcake take out Money Inc., but there's no referee. Who's going to make this three count? Jimmy Hart produces this pinstriped jacket of his, and he makes a three count, but of course it doesn't really count, but they act like it does. They act like, oh, we won the belts. Yay, they're posing with the belts. Like, they think they really won. But then Danny Davis, the second referee, comes out and disqualifies the Mega Maniacs for them colliding with the referee, the first referee, I should say. So Money Inc. retain the belts. The Mega Maniacs deck Danny Davis and celebrate despite not winning anything. They open IRS's Halliburton briefcase. They grab the tax forms, the money out there, and start handing the money out to fans in the front row. You know, what can you say about this match? It was, you know, for Hogan's big return, it wasn't anything to write home about. It wasn't very special. And the finish also was a bad taste in my mouth. I'm going to give this one 1.5 stars. I think the reason I think the finish just didn't sit so well with me was just the delay they had. The referee getting knocked out, and then Jimmy Hart does this ridiculous fake three count, and then the faces celebrate as if they won, which, like, I think they've been wrestling long enough to know that, you know, no, Jimmy, just wearing the pinstripe jacket does not give you the powers of a referee. I don't know if you ever went to referee school. I don't know if you have the license for that, but no, it doesn't count. Up next, Mr. Perfect taking on the narcissist Lex Luger in Luger's WrestleMania debut. This is also one of the few times he would wrestle as the narcissist gimmick. We'll get to that in a minute. But first, Mr. Perfect turned face at Survivor Series 92 after going against Ric Flair and Bobby Heenan's team. So Luger debuted as a narcissist under Bobby Heenan's employ as kind of a way to get back at Mr. Perfect. This happened at the Royal Rumble 93. This happens after the World Bodybuilding Federation folded because Luger was signed under the deal with WBF. But then when that went down, Luger now became a wrestler once again for the WWF. Pretty decent match here. Of course, Mr. Perfect, Kurt Hennig, could work with anybody and make him look good. Luger, I think he got a bad rap in his career. I think Luger could do well if he was given the right opponents and the right circumstances. He wasn't always shitty. When he was bad, it was bad. But when he was good, it was fine. I think he was a fine wrestler given the right amount of circumstances. So Luger looks well here. Now, no one's ever said the officiating in wrestling has ever been consistent, so you can't really get mad at this specific match. But I mean, it does play into why this match isn't that great, because the referee is very inconsistent in the way he enforces rules. Like, he's very observant when Luger's in the ropes on two occasions. Within like 30 seconds after that pinfall, Luger has Perfect in a backslide. Perfect's feet are very much in the ropes, and the referee just counts 1, 2, 3. It wasn't an issue of a crooked ref. It was just like that happened and the referee screwed up, but it makes him look dumb after being so observant of Luger. So that was what it was. Luger wins, and I give this match 1.5 stars out of 4. Luger KOs Perfect with that forearm with the metal plate, which was an ongoing thing with him. So he KOs Perfect. After the match, Perfect gets up and chases Luger backstage. They have a bit of a scuffle into some pile of boxes, but Shawn Michaels, who was kind of like slightly bumped in that altercation, starts taking out Perfect. Perfect and Michaels would have a rivalry going until SummerSlam 93. So that's kind of how the jumping off point for that feud was here at WrestleMania 9. I mean, honestly, the best part of this match was the introduction when Luger comes out with like the four ladies in the gold bikinis and they have the mirrors and the sparklers coming out. That's the part anyone remembers from this match. The only real takeaway here in this entire thing. Luger would not hold on to this gimmick for very long because later in the year, after Hogan left the company, Luger was rebranded as the All-American Lex Luger, and he body slammed Yokozuna on the USS Intrepid, and he toured the country in the Lex Express campaigning as if he were president, although he's just trying to get fans to like him. It didn't work out, needless to say. Oh boy, up next you got The Undertaker versus Giant Gonzalez. There's a reason this match is always glossed over in those hype packages about The Undertaker and his WrestleMania history and the streak. They never show you any highlights about this match because there are no highlights. What's the highlight? You've got the stare down, which is the best part of the whole match. You've got Giant Gonzalez looking down at Taker, which happens so rarely. So that was a cool visual. Here's the story in case you care. Undertaker was feuding with Harvey Whippleman, the manager, and the Whippleman's guy was Kamala for a while. Taker beats Kamala, then out comes Giant Gonzalez, who was formerly El Gigante in WCW, only now he's wearing this ridiculous jumpsuit with a bunch of like airbrushed naked man thing on it. I don't know what they were thinking giving him that outfit. It was not a flattering look, to say the least. You know, what can be said about Gonzalez? He was very immobile then in WCW. He's not any better now in WWF, and he doesn't sell very well. It's the one thing he's hired to do is like look big and wrestle, and he can't even do the wrestling part. So, you know, this match, it's, you know, there's maybe 5 bumps taken the entire match, and they're all Undertaker. Gonzalez smothers Taker Undertaker with it, and the match ends in a disqualification. Three DQ finishes in the biggest show of the year. Neither guy looks very good in this match. Long live the streak! I give it 1.5 star. So the referees are trying to break it up. Gonzalez chokeslams referee Bill Alfonso, which I guess is so funny to see Alfonso in any kind of role besides what he did in ECW with Taz and Sabu. Taker is taken out on a stretcher, but he runs back into the arena and starts beating up Gonzalez. He clotheslines him a couple times, and Gonzalez does take a bump. I think it's one bump of the year, apparently. And that's pretty much that. And, you know, like I said, there's a reason this match is not glorified in the WrestleMania Undertaker hype packages. My favorite, you know, story about this is how Bruce Pritchard says that, you know, Taker would hold that against him and the company for years. He's like, you know, you put me against Giant Gonzalez, right? I just love that story. Backstage, a man who is not involved in the main event cuts a promo on the main event. Should we be concerned? Is the Symbolic King?
That's why right now, Bret Hart, I'm issuing a challenge to either you or the Jap, brother.
Main event time, the World Championship on the line as Bret Hart defends against Yokozuna with Mr. Fuji in his corner. Now, of course, Yoko for months and months has been booked as this unstoppable killing machine. He won the Rumble match at 93 to earn the right to fight for the championship here. My favorite part in this match is there's a USA chant and neither man is from America. It's a pretty good big man, little man matchup here. If you compare it to the previous match, Taker and Gonzalez, which was a total shit show, this match was a masterpiece by comparison, even though it wasn't without its faults. Like, I do remember hearing Bret Hart talk about how Yokozuna, like, skipped a lot of stuff that they were going to be doing, and they kind of had to rush the finish, which I know it sounded like really upset Bret here, but it was still done pretty well. I mean, Yoko, like, he's still in better shape here than he would be just a few years later, and Bret's kind of just bouncing off him to make him look super intimidating, but it still works and still looks good. Bret does the unthinkable and knocks Yokozuna off his feet. He gets him in a sharpshooter, and as he's in the hold, Mr. Fuji throws salt in the eyes of Bret Hart. Yoko pins Bret to become the new World Wrestling Federation champion. I give this match 2 stars. Again, it was a very good big man, little man match for what it was. But wait, there's more, because Hulk Hogan, like I said, the man who was not involved in this match at all, he immediately enters the match. He enters the ring and tries to stand up and defend Bret Hart's honor. Fuji instantly makes a challenge saying, we'll fight you right now. We'll put the title on the line. Then a leg drop. 1, 2, 3. Hulk Hogan is the new World Wrestling Federation champion. What the fuck? 1.5 star. There's a lot to unpack here, because if you just consider the massive history and all the evidence of Hogan using his backstage clout to influence the product, this whole thing just reeks of Hogan influence and Hogan ego and saying, you know, gotta send the fans home happy, brother. You know, Bruce Pritchard said in his podcast about this, apparently the decision was made to put the belt on Hogan for him to be the champion in an upcoming European tour, but apparently the tour was already sold out. They didn't need to have Hogan as champion to sell more tickets, but Bruce's rationale was we wanted to give them more value for their dollar. But I mean, okay, that's kind of a noble goal, but I mean, like the old saying goes, you already got their money, it's already in your pocket. By the way, Hogan would not be in that European tour, oddly enough. There's a lot of confusion as to what actually happened. There's a lot of different he said about like what happened with the belt here. Apparently Bret says he was told that Hogan wouldn't drop the belt to Bret, but Hogan was told he was going to drop the belt to the top heel at the time, which is Yokozuna. Hogan would go on to hold the belt until King of the Ring that year for a couple of months. He would lose after getting a fireball to the face by an evil Japanese photographer, and Yoko would become the champion yet again. And of course, that was the last time we'd see Hogan for many, many years. We wouldn't see him again in the WWF until 2002 when the NWO came to the show there. So yeah, really shitty way to end this pay-per-view that was kind of not doing well to begin with. It starts off strong and then just goes downhill mighty quick. As far as the other parties in this debacle are concerned, Bret would go on to win the championship 4 more times before leaving the company in 1997. Yokozuna would feud with the All-American Lex Luger after winning the belt at King of the Ring and he being body slammed in the USS Intrepid, like I mentioned. And of course, Hogan would go on to sign with WCW 1 year after leaving the WWF. So there you go. That's how it ends, man. My final grade for WrestleMania 9 is an F+. I give it the plus because the two saving graces this entire show were the first two matches on the card. Shawn Michaels and Tatanka, even though it had a DQ finish, 1 of 3. And then you also have the Headshrinkers and the Steiner Brothers. Those two matches were great. They were diamonds in the rough compared to everything else on this show. It went downhill in a real big hurry. You know, Taker and Gonzalez was crap. Razor Ramon and Backlund didn't need to be there. Lex Luger's entrance was better than his match. Bret and Yoko would have been a fine way to end the show, but Hogan had to get involved and dick it all up. I'm watching this show, I'm two matches in, I'm thinking to myself, huh, maybe Mania 9 gets a bad rap. Maybe there's more redeeming things about this show than we give it credit for. No, this show deserves all the scorn it could possibly get. It is truly one of the worst, if not the worst, Manias of all time. Of course, that's for you to decide. So that'll do it for this week's classic pay-per-view review. Thanks once again to Mitchell Janda and Tim Russell for nominating it. I had a fun time reviewing the show, even if I didn't have a fun time watching it, if that makes any sense. If you want to play a role determining which classic shows I review in the future, be they good or bad, go to patreon.com/wrestlingwithregret, become a $10 backer or above, and you will have the honor, the privilege of telling me which shows I get to review in the future. Next time on the review, I'm doing my first ever TNA pay-per-view review. It's going to be Lockdown 2008. Hope to see you there. Be sure to thumbs up this video if you like it. Comment below, subscribe to Wrestling With Regret, and buy the t-shirts at ProWrestlingTees.com. I'm Brian Zane, and I'll see you next time.